the Copenhagen or Copenhagen campaign that has just been launched with the Secretary General of the UN, which is targeted very much at the Copenhagen conference in December. That campaign is there to seal the deal, to make sure that the targets that are fixed are stretching targets for us in terms of climate change. And just to underline what you heard over the last hour or so, this is a campaign that we think is extremely important in dynamizing and activating the targets that we think should be reached in December. And we urge all of you to be behind the campaign as much as possible. We'll come on to corporate social responsibility, the environment and sustainability in the next hour or so. But you have before you four major packaged goods companies. I should mention that we were hoping to have a financial brand here, but Nigel Gilbert of Lloyds TSB unfortunately was ill, and we're very grateful to Brian Perkins for stepping in a very big way from J&J. But you have in front of you four corporations that represent in market capitalization over $400 billion, have turnover of over $200 billion, have 755,000 employees, people around the world, and spend on advertising, according to which statistic you like, either at age $15.5 billion, or I like much more TNS media spends at $16.5 billion. So if you want a more bullish forecast, you go to TNS. But having said that, these four companies represent major investors in advertising and marketing services. And I just want to introduce them briefly in alphabetical order. This has nothing to do with budgets. It has nothing to do with preferences. The first is Mary Dillon on my right, who is the only one actually who's not a lifer. You've not been for all of your life at McDonald's. You've been at Pepsi Foods before, on Quaker, and you're one of the two on the panel who's not an MBA. So you're quite a product of the academic system. And currently, Mary is Executive Vice President and Global Chief Marketing Officer of McDonald's. In the light-colored jacket, Brian Perkins, who's Vice President of Corporate Affairs at J&J, a Wharton alumnus, Rutgers as well, before that, worked in the flooring business, so then on Tylenol, President of McNeil, launched Splendor around the world, admitted to me this morning that he was an agency groupie and did flirt with the idea after business school of joining an agency. I'm glad to say that all our agencies offered him a job, but ultimately chose to go to J&J. Marc Pritchard here is the Global Marketing Officer and recently Chief Brand Officer of Procter & Gamble, the world's largest advertiser, a P&G lifer, 27 years, no MBA, they're also the most intelligent on the panel. At least there are some of the audience that are. And last but not least, Mary Beth West, EVP and Chief Marketing Officer of Kraft, another lifer, 22 years, a graduate of Columbia Business School before that, but we won't call that an extra either, and Hanselwood University before that. So three lifers, one recent joinee. What I'd like to do is to touch on some of the things that I think have been troubling us in the advertising and marketing services industry, and life is not particularly easy at the moment. To put it mildly, we see a tough 2009. It started off quite tough in the first quarter, and to our point of view, it's got even tougher in April and May of this year. And we think the rest of the year will not be exactly easy. And I'd like to start off, we've got an hour, I'd like to start off by asking the panel, maybe we can start off with Mary first. What's been happening to your spending, your investment in advertising and marketing services at the moment? I mean, if I look at the data for the four companies represented here, it's variable. I actually think probably McDonald's has probably been the heaviest investor, incremental investor, in 2009. So maybe you could say a little bit about what you've been doing in traditional media, offline and online, how you've been mixing the spend, what changes you've been making. Have the financial functions and procurement functions been putting so much pressure on you at the dollars that you had to change your thinking? So,
so yes, we are in fact, our spending is a function of sales, and sales are up, but we are absolutely doing two things. One is rethinking the mix of the spending all the time, and certainly with a week like this, it leaves you thinking even more about are we doing the right, you know, spending in the right places. But, you know, it's interesting, what some might call old media, television, is still actually the largest portion of our spending, quite effective for us. But of course, digital is the fastest
growing portion now. I mean, it's difficult to make the distinction. What proportion now do we spend it? We know worldwide about 13% of client budgets are online. What proportion is spending?
It varies for us by market, certainly depending on the development of digital behaviors in the market. But on average, about 7% of our global spend is digital. Sounds small, but it's the fastest growing. And given our scale, that enables us to have a strong presence. But you know, certainly, it's all about how do we stop thinking about media silos and start thinking about, you know, consumer engagement and
Marc, I think one of the biggest impacts the recession has had on us is we invest a lot more time in communications planning. Because no stone is left unturned. And we look for value. Right? And we look for transferring great creative ideas in the best possible way. And my guess is it's probably true for most companies, or certainly it's for our company. There's no shortage of people who tell you to cut or how to cut. And we look for evangelists. We are hoping that advertising and communication evangelists step up with great ideas, with courage, that we can invest in. So we're spending a lot of time on the plan.
Just on that point, because that is an interesting point, and I think it's the point that troubles us to some extent. Do you think that the marketing function, not necessarily subtract from J&J, generally is less important in these times, or has become less important in the last few years, and that the procurement and financial functions have gained ascendancy and are dictating what happens inside companies?
One, I think marketing and advertising is more important in these times. Two, on the issue of procurement, near and dear subject to all. Look, I think procurement has a very important role to play in how we conduct our businesses. I would tell you, as somebody who grew up in this business, traditionally, our fees have been handled by junior marketing people who generally weren't too good at negotiation, didn't like it, didn't like playing the bad cop. Now we have professionals that can help. But at the same time, I think it's really important for marketers not to use procurement as a shield. Right? Have to engage in this, and it has to be a balance. Because if we're not incenting you and agencies for the behavior we want, it's not going to work. It's got to be a balance.
Mark, do you want to say about Procter? I mean, A.G. Lafley, I think in public statements, has mentioned that P&G's advertising budgets have down about 4% and has justified that in part or in whole in terms of better value. Do you want to just say what P&G has been doing?
I mean, look, I think, Martin, what the recession has done, I think, for our company and for the industry as a whole, it really allowed us all to step back and hit the reset button and really recalibrate. recalibrate and rethink how we're doing everything. We've got a very clear purpose, which is to improve the lives of consumers. We went out and talked to consumers. What they said they were looking for is they were looking for value, and they were looking for things that were valuable to them. So that caused us to look at everything. And so from a media marketing training standpoint, certainly we looked at how we could get more value out of that. That was through a mix of media, shifting into where the consumer was in other places. It was through rate negotiations, as you would expect. But the other thing that I think is more important is impact and its creativity. And we spent a great deal of time very quickly going out and on every one of our big brands, made sure that we had messages to consumers that talked about how our brands were of value and how they were valuable to them. And I think that has made the biggest difference in what we've done. It's not just price. On Pampers, we came up with Golden Sleep, which is an idea that Pampers can give you, your baby, 12 hours of golden sleep, which is, by the way, Golden Sleep for mom as well. And that was a great value to them. And we did this on Olay, where we reframed the value of Olay versus department stores. So Good Housekeeping said that Regenerist for under $30 was better than a $300 department store. That's what consumers were looking for. So it was value in the spending, and it was valuable in the creativity, so we would have greater impact.
Mary says 7% on spending. Well, how much is that?
We're well into double digits.
Well into double digits. Where's Procter on that spot?
Very by country. Same thing. In some countries it's double digits, in some countries it's more than marriage range. There's clearly an inflection point shift in digital. I think that was evident this entire week. That now we're starting to figure out how to really integrate digital into the rest of the mix. And the way we also think about it as well is we like to think about taking our messages and making sure that they work from the store all the way back. So the store is where everybody is. Then there's digital, there's PR, there's TV and print. So there's a lot of different ways we can reach consumers.
There was a survey published this morning saying that Fortune 100 CEOs don't engage in social media. They're not social media savvy. Is that one of the reasons why budgets are at 7% or low double digits? They should, in theory, be at 20, because we spend 20% of our time online. Is it because the people who lead the companies are not as vitally interested in this area as maybe the consumers are?
I don't think there's a direct relationship between the percent of time that people spend and how much we should spend. I think it's all about finding way to make sure that we're breaking through with the right ideas at the right time. So, we're all going to, I'm sure, at least I can speak for ourselves, be increasing the amount that we spend in digital for sure. But the amount that we spend gives us a lot of impact and presence. Now it's about how do we make sure that it's absolutely engaging and enjoyable for people.
I think it's a great point, Martin. So, and I actually see it as part of my responsibility to ensure that the key executives at Kraft are at least semi-well-versed in this space. So we actually took Irene's staff, we went down to Google, we spent a full day down there just playing around in a very, non-threatening, comfortable environment, learning. And do I know what they're going to do next week? No. But I'm getting more comfortable that at least if we're going to have a dialogue about it, we can go back.
How much do you spend in Kraft now?
We're in double digits.
And what about your spending as a whole? I mean, Kraft, like McDonald's, was challenged by the trends in food consumption, issues about obesity, health, and the like of the positioning of the company. Obviously, the recession emphasizing value has shifted that issue a little bit. I mean, what have you done in terms of your spending? Because my impression, looking at the data, is that you're up this year.
We're actually very bullish on food. Recession, believe it or not, is a bit of an opportunity for us. One of the first things folks stopped doing was eating away from home, except of course at the time, but at least in the more casual dining. So for us, what Marc was saying is defining the value proposition and understanding why a consumer with a discrete amount of dollars in their pocket is going to pull out the extra 50 cents or whatever it's going to cost for ours versus what the retailer brand is. Once you've got that value proposition, you absolutely must spend into it. Otherwise, the consumer's not going to know. So one of the things we did, is we took a look at those eating trends. We said, how do we help consumers find a food solution that they're having to sacrifice by not eating out anymore? So we provided recipes that come from some of those casual restaurant dining out places that they enjoyed having. But if recipe ideas as there are talking about how to transform their home and not sacrifice the entire experience.
Let me just move to structure at the moment, because Marc, in addition to being sort of chief marketing officer, I'm a sort of chief marketing officer, chief marketing officer of the Procter & Gamble, you're also chief branding officer, or global branding officer, and the world's biggest advertiser, the world's biggest marketer. When you move or change direction or change structure, I think everybody examines that. And some will follow, but we'll certainly all look at it. You're now going to be responsible as CMO or branding officer for advertising, for media investment management, as we call it, for design, package design, for research, market research, as I understand it, and as of most recently, public relations. You will have vast resources and investment budget at your disposal. What is the reason why Procter have started to focus on the BAL brand franchise alignment structure, and you're demanding quite rightly that your agencies respond likewise?
It's really all about integration. That's really what it's about. It's about integrating all of our brand building activities so we can go out and touch and improve the lives of more consumers around the world a lot more quickly. I think we have great capabilities, both within our company and function and with our agencies, of different skills and disciplines. And they're great individually, but what they need to be is better together. And so what we're doing is we're making structural changes to do that. We've already, on about 50% of our sales, we have brand franchise leaders who are global in nature and who really integrate all the functions to get things around the world globally. And not a lot of companies do that. We've now moved to brand agency leader model in a third of our businesses, so we can integrate the agencies. So rather than brief everyone individually, we brief them all together so you can come up with integrated ideas and move them more quickly around the world. And now internally, we're also integrating all of our disciplines, because that'll just really create speed and allow us to more rapidly build great ideas. A lot of it, you know, it really comes down to what we see, I think some increasing examples here at hand, is the integrated creativity that we need. Those great brand-building ideas that we can then integrate at every consumer touch point and come together to create something larger than individual pieces.
Now, Brian, in probably what was the largest account switch last year, J&J consolidated its U.S. pharma business. And you consolidated it ultimately with two holding parent companies. What you did was to consolidate or force the agencies, if I put it that way, to consolidate existing resources. You didn't say, let's start it from scratch. What was the thinking behind that? And is that something that J&J is going to take further, either outside the United States or in other areas of its business beyond the U.S. government?
Consistent with what we just heard from Marc, it's about integration, helping our folks develop holistic ideas, and frankly, we love our agencies. We love the services, but we're still waiting for the day where the sum of a holding company is greater than the sum of parts. I should say the whole is greater than the sum of the parts.
But aren't there problems in size? The bigger these things get, the bigger you get, the bigger we get, the bigger the problems get. Are there diseconomies of scale, do you think? Are you worried about that?
Not the way, for instance, WPP is structured.
I wasn't asking you that. Although it's very good that you did, and I'm delighted you replaced Nigel Gilbert, which I'm sure you could have said that. But it isn't size an issue. You know, the trade press is full of pro-David and anti-Goliath stories. And the emphasis will always be that way. Maybe rightly so, maybe wrongly so, but always be that way. Is that something that worries you?
Martin, it doesn't. Not if we do it right. Whether it's with WPP, we have a terrific relationship, similar with IPG and Omnicom and many of our businesses. And sometimes we need your scale. Right? This is, on the other hand, not all of our businesses do. So we can work really effectively with a mother. We love mother. They're a bunch of great people, get in a room, they work things out in a very different way. But you mentioned Johnson & Johnson, that's a packaged company, we are. as you well know, 3/4 of our business is prescription drugs and medical devices. If not all smaller agencies can handle that kind of rigor on a regulatory basis, on a science basis around the world. Okay.
Mary Beth and Mary, now what about scale and size? I mean, my impression is that Kraft, for example, does use small agencies. I've seen in the design area, you use smaller agencies, or on recent identity projects, you use smaller agencies. What do you feel about this issue about size, whether holding companies or parent companies can deliver the necessary or not? And so, within the comments on that.
We try to find the people who can help us solve the problems. So that's what we'd like to work with. I think the way we like to approach it is, I don't have a bias on size. Larger is not necessarily better. I do have a bias on good versus bad. And so there's a nimbleness that seems to be emerging with some of these new models and these new agencies. And I don't know where that's going to go, but I have to keep an open mind so that we're constantly looking at what those models might be and how we might integrate them. I think with the large ones, it all comes down to the people. And if you got the relationship and you have great communication, you can get to great ideas. If you don't, large or small, it doesn't matter, you won't get to the great idea. And I think that's the part that's been missing.
I would just add, sometimes size matters. And by that, what I mean is that, you know, in our instance, you know, we are all focused on bringing our brand promise to life through all of our touch points. And we feel like we've got a lot of work to do, but we have great agencies on board to help us get that done. We're a highly decentralized company, we operate in 118 countries, so we do a lot of work. There's a lot of work that's produced. And we have global agencies, you know, TBWA, LeoVernet, DDB, and they have offices all around the world. And their size and scale absolutely is critical to helping us get done what we need to get done. But we also work with smaller firms, you know, whether it's packaging design, whether it's a new innovation in digital. But each one of our agencies is accountable for helping us be integrated in our thinking. And one of the things we're trying to do, okay, we're not structurally so integrated, but I'll tell you, we're creating forums. So just this last week, we had our creative directors from all over the world here together with us from all agencies to talk about how we're going to elevate our work and inspire more creativity. So that's the way we're trying to get at innovation.
Now, what can is wonderful, even in a year when award entries are down by 40%, attendance is down by 40%. One of the things the organizers don't let us do is to have interactive sessions. There's not much Q&A from the floor. So try to use an element of technology. My email address is msorrell@wpp.com. If any of you in the audience have a question, please email me now, and I will ask the panel. We did this last year with Google and Microsoft and AOL and Yahoo, and we got a few interesting ones. I'm sure we'll get some interesting ones in the audience. So please email me.
Mark,
me
second. Can I
surprise question?
Can I give you my email address if they
want
the
answers? Let me come back to strategy for a minute. Now, we're very focused on new markets based in the BRICS Next 11, and Cannes is very interesting because in the last couple of years we've now seen the emergence, thankfully, of more entries from India and China and Asia and Latin America. Not enough, in my view. Africa and the Middle East and Central Eastern Europe also have a significant role to play. But that's core to our strategy, and the reason is we think it's core to your strategies as global companies. That's one area. The second area is new media, and the third is consumer insight. And Mark, maybe I could just start with you first. Paul McDonald has just been appointed CEO of Procter. And in his opening remarks, or on the first day when he was responding to press inquiries, I think he said that Procter had, what is it, 2.5 billion or 3.5 billion? 3.5 billion consumers around the world. That he wanted to attract at least another billion, and that the bulk of those would come from India and China. Now, thinking about those three pillars, it's BRICS and Next 11, digital and consumer insight. How does that interface with Procter? And Mary, I'm going to talk to you about analytics, because I know that you're extremely keen on the role of analytics, maybe to the chagrin of some of the people in the audience or outside this room.
Well, it's very clear that there's a lot of consumers now that we have the opportunity to reach in the emerging markets. And this is going to include China and India and in Latin America and a number of different places. You know, one of the fundamental things that we have to do, and I would actually relate this to the prior question I just talked about, that, you know, size. if you're focused on touching the consumers and going where they live and listening to them face-to-face and going shopping with them and staying connected with them. I actually think that the digital world gives us an even greater opportunity to stay connected with them because many of these markets are way advanced in terms of where they are from a mobile standpoint. You know, I think it's going to really change brand building in an interesting way. A lot of the things that we do from a brand building standpoint are at the village level. We go out and work with the villages to identify who would be our distributor, and then we connect with them. And we have a great picture that was just from in Africa, where we have our village distributor, who is essentially the representative of the brand, and the brand, P&G, distributes. And behind him was a cell phone tower. And he had didn't have a TV or didn't have a radio and didn't have a number of different things, but he had a mobile and his wife had a BlackBerry. So if you think about what marketing is going to look like and brand building is going to look like, it's going to be a very deep personal one-to-one connection, and then it's going to be that connection to technology. We do in Egypt, in many of our countries, we do brand building through brands. We basically go from village to village in mobile places and on mobile villages and give all sorts of tips and bring pediatricians and pampers and those kinds of things. So it all is connected. China's got more digital connection than the United States now. So that's clearly an area where we're investing.
Just to reinforce that on mobile, it strikes us as extraordinary that China mobile has 450 million subscribers, probably trending now to 500 million. There were 650 million in China, there's about 250 in India, again, 500 million, 250 million in Africa, and 500 million. So that mobile is obviously going to have an extreme impact. You want to just talk about consumer insight from Procter's point of view? We're making a big bet at WPP on that 4 billion out of 15 billion in research.
What is really crucial, and one of the expectations that we have from our agency partners, is creativity.
For brand promise around the world, that's about providing simple, easy enjoyment, you know, great food and great value conveniently, and that takes very different shape all around the world in terms of how we get at that and what insights we need to make it relevant. So that is absolutely our thought process on that. And so, the notion of analytics, while it's not terribly sexy, I mean, I'm a big fan of both the art and the science of marketing, and feel that, you know, while in some industries analytics are standard, you know, we do them all the time, in others we're still learning, and I think one of the things that we're advancing at McDonald's is not just the front end, what's the real insight, what's the real problem you're trying to solve, but the back end, really understanding what was effective in the marketplace, because while we're thrilled that we're doing well, the only way we're going to continue to do well is if we understand what's driving the most effectiveness in the marketplace in terms of consumer response. So we're advancing that pretty aggressively.
So you agree with the IAB work that we see at Marriott, which says clients are identifying 89% of the sample, identify consumer insight as the key issue, the key point that agencies can deliver. Marriott?
Yeah, I think it goes just a step beyond the insight, it's the translation of the insight. I think along the lines of what Marc was saying, lots of data, lots of information. How to serve it up in an elegant manner so it just truly provides a compelling proposition to the consumer is really the challenge. I think that's a role the agencies used to play through the planning role, and I'm not sure what happened, but we're not getting it. I think we're having to solve for it internally. And if you think about insights as sort of three parts, analytics, research, and planning, it's that planning, which is the translation, that I think is the biggest
Okay, well, just to that point, should media planning and buying be repotted into the full service agency? Should we put them back together again or not?
No, I think for us, we're seeing the media agencies emerge as some of the more creative problem solvers and ideators in this new world. And as I was talking to somebody about it last night, they said, I think it's a matter of survival. In a world where I think the old world, the agencies were always way out in front of the clients. I think what we're seeing is a change in the race. And I think clients are out in front of agencies, and I think the consumer is way out in front of all of us. So in some cases, I think it might have been a mistake to break it apart. Don't know that it really matters in the end, though. It's all about the idea, and how where the idea comes from shouldn't matter.
Now, to that point, there are some who believe the medium is becoming, or has become, more important than the message. Historically, in our industry, the message was created, the idea was created, and that then we saw about people, with fragmentation, digitization, has that changed, or do you think the big idea is still the key thing, and then you sort out?
I think sometimes the medium is the idea. The medium is the message. I think, you know, we launched our iFood Assistant, which is our iPhone app, in just about Thanksgiving time last year. To me, that medium is in fact our message, 8,000 recipes at your fingertips, available to any consumer for 99 cents. I don't know how to separate what that idea is from the way we delivered it. It's totally not known.
Okay. Brian, a little bit maybe on media planning and buying and also the streaming issues, but TV, Marc just raised a point about TV and the future of TV, and that's one of the questions from the audience. Newspapers, magazines dropping like flies, not an exaggeration, in mature markets at least, maybe not so much in the faster growing markets. What's the future of TV? You're investing more in television now, given the fact it's cheaper?
I'm always struck by the fact that on these panels and on our workshops, there's hardly any talk of TV. But all the viewing rooms, everybody's being turned on by TV. We love TV. TV can only do certain things, right? The reach, the mass reach on TV is phenomenal. We love it. We're not going to go and spend crazy if that one's not there. Right? But I think the recession has brought upon some reality around the world on television. I think it's a good place to be. It's not the only place.
But is TV paying the price for 10 years or 15 years? I can remember when we acquired JWT in 1987, the Red Polar went to the networks and said, you can't charge us more for less. So for something like 20, 22 years, the price of network television escalated before beyond general price inflation consistently. And because of the monopolistic position, or let's say the oligopolistic position that the networks had, the three then, you could argue now, maybe four or five now, they exacted that price. I'll come on to that in relation to media and digital in a second. Are they making price cut now that it was too good to last?
Well, look, the networks around the world, they're good partners, of course. Are they paying the price up a little bit? Right? I would put it, they're waking up to a new reality. And we're going to drive a tough negotiation, right? And but you know what? It all works out better when you work in partnership. And that's what we're really trying to do. Are they paying the price a little bit? I think they are.
Okay. Well, then we could be going from the frying pan into the fire. Because when you look at the search marketplace, Google in the United States has 65%. Bing has, according to our data, in the first couple of weeks, Steve Ballmer said it didn't work on a 2-week plan. It's more a 6-month year. But what we see on Bing from the compete data we have already is trial is up and trial is maintained. In other words, the consumers seem to be liking a little bit of what they see. But is it frying pan? Are you worried about the concentration of search share outside the US? It's even worse in some markets. Would you like to see more balance in the marketplace and search share?
This whole question about medium and message, the way we look at it again is, it's part of the reset button of the recession, and it's another opportunity. Because the competition that is being created by all of the emerging new mediums, and I believe now the fact that we're all starting to master some ways to use them and integrate them, I think that just moves everything to another level of innovation. And I think that's the great thing about recessions and these kinds of things. You recalibrate and you rethink and then you innovate. And I believe that's where it's going to go. I think that the competition will be fierce from a price standpoint, but it's going to actually increase the competition for ideas. And our opportunity as brand builders in this room is to just step back and say, what is it about our brand that is either a promise or uniquely touches you through life? What is the big brand building idea, bigger idea? And then how do we make sure that it can be brought to life in some very innovative ways? One of the best initiatives we've had at using virtually every medium right now is a Gillette gaming initiative, Gillette Champions Gaming. And this was an idea that was born out of, men like to shave, but they like to play games more. And we created a gaming platform that allowed them to virtually
Maybe you're worried about balance in the search market, like we used not to have such balance in the network market.
No,
it's
not. Got a lot of things to worry about. I think Marc is right. I think it's how do you take the idea and execute it in a way that brings it to life for a target in a way that connects with that target consumer. I'll give you a great example from Brazil. We have a brand that comes from Social, and it is a large cracker. And our targets are something we characterize as urban nomad. 20-year-old guy, hangs out in bars, goes to school, maybe still living with mom, got a girlfriend, a bike, you know, hangs out at the beach. So we did a briefing with the agency at a bar because we wanted the environment to reflect the environment that our target spends time in. And one of the stories I heard was, did the briefing, I don't know what's going on at the bar during the briefing, so that's a good idea, but there was a board that was left out of the door. And we got finished with the briefing and the team said, do you have anything bigger? And there, well, there's that one other idea. So we went and got the bag, pulled the board out, and we ended up executing a man-made island off the coast of one of the beaches where we created extreme sports and partying and all kinds of activity, and we voted our target urban nomads back and forth to the island. The business is up 40%. 65% of the money we spent on the was on information. The challenge now is
but this is
the
So, you know, if I try to put myself in your position, at times like this, there's a premium on efficiency, on reducing cost. New media, absolute cost. I move $10 million from TV into new media, I can maybe spend 1 or 2 million and keep the 8, I put it in R&D or innovation, or I put it straight to profit. Because the CEO is giving me a hard time about me picking it up. So, and the CFO, and the procurement. Isn't that a little bit about what's going on? I mean, I look at GM, used to spend 2 billion, and coming out of the receivership, I had a chat with them, and it's going to spend, what, 50 million a month? About 600 million. That's about 25% of what we used to spend. The bulk of it is going to be spent on that. Isn't that a little bit about what's happening? What difference is that going to make to you?
Well, clearly, what people want to consume in any screen is visual images that are generally moving. So digital. I think it's absolutely certain that most of what people want to consume is going to continue to be visual. It doesn't really matter what medium it comes from. But I just want to reiterate, I think if the folks here are earlier listening from us, it's not so much. I think the discussion is too much about the channel and not enough about the ideas of the business.
Okay.
I don't.
You don't.
I'd like to.
back to something we didn't talk about before, we didn't touch on before, and that's retail and the rise of retail as if it was a country, it would be the seventh largest country in the world in retail, and retail sales for $400 billion. And everybody stopped saying in Seattle that he saw something, his objective was to see Walmart share of US retail value to maybe 10 to 16 or 20. What challenges, and it's not so much for McDonald's, but very much for Kraft and J&J or something particularly proper, what challenges, and I'm getting at in a way that I see P&G have invested in Ocado, which is a direct consumer retail operation in the UK. What challenges in the rise of retail that I'm going to have for you?
Pure and children's safe drinking water to save lives. We've got Pampers.
saw that immensely impressive three-piece diagram of P&G's carbon footprint, showing the hideous use of carbon in settings in home laundry, use of electricity, and cold water detergents reduced.
And Ariel, which just went to a cold water plumbing this week, and wash in 30 degrees Celsius, which allows you to reduce your electricity and get clean clothes. And that's something that helps all of us.
Right. CSR is part of the ethos of Johnson & Johnson.
It's a mission statement.
It's part of our mission statement. It's what drives Johnson & Johnson. And it's not something that comes into fashion today, yesterday, or 4 years ago. We've been in it for 100 years. We love babies and mothers, and we're dedicated to helping them save lives, life-changing healthcare improvements, especially the most needy in the world. And two, we want to help increase healthcare capacity. We have a dream, and it's a dream. We don't want to ever see a baby born HIV positive. There's no reason for it anymore in today's day and age. But 1,000 babies are born every year of HIV positive. And so we work with local NGOs around the world to help with that. Right? And if there is an intervention, two-thirds of those babies every year will die of HIV. Not a good situation. On sustainability, we're a healthcare company. We believe without a healthy planet, there are not healthy people. It's that simple. We have aggressive goals. We measure them. We are achieving them. We have the largest fleet of hybrid cars in the U.S. company. We're the second largest user of solar energy. This is a long-term commitment.
Our three platforms are hunger, healthy lifestyles, and sustainability. And I'll just talk to two of them quickly. Our hunger platform, we do a partnership with Feeding America. And you know, this just goes to show that great ideas can be applied anywhere. And we came up with this idea of creating mobile food pantries. Part of the issue with food and the number of people who are requiring assistance in food consumption globally now is that they cannot get to the food pantry. So if you can't get to the food pantry, it doesn't do as much good. We're creating refrigerated trucks that are 60-65% fresh produce, supplemented with Kraft products, and it allows us to take the pantry into the areas of most need to serve the community. The other idea, we've been working on is a partnership within sustainability with the Gates Foundation. We recently announced a $90 million 5-year commitment with them on sustainable farming in the area of cocoa, cashews, and coffee in Africa. We know that we can change life for the better in Africa if we get this right. And so the partnership between Kraft and the foundation, I think, is the first step.
Now, following Bob Gale's example, we're going to extend it. The red light is coming, but we'll just extend one last question. Very quickly, in one sentence or two sentences, what things drive you nuts about the agencies that you do? What is the thing that drives you crazy each day? What's the thing you'd like to remedy? Not about our agencies, but other people's agencies. Let's start with the problem.
I think as the marketing has changed, as the delivery has changed, as digital has been infused into our lives, we've employed new principles to market our products and our brands, and we're forgetting to deploy those same principles in our relationship with one another. It comes back to people and relationships. Clients and agencies do not have relationships. People have relationships. And if there's one thing I could change, I'd roll the clock back 20 years, I'd sit down with a cup of coffee and have the quality and intensity of the conversations I've had over the last 3 days that have far surpassed any conversation I've had with a current agency or future agency in the last 6 months.
I would like to say that in current circumstances, that philosophy is not the problem. Very admirable. Come back again.
Right. I really don't love the question. I happen to believe the old adage, clients get the advertising they deserve. Something that drives us, Chris, we're in this together.
And I, what drives me crazy is when we don't provide really clear, really crisp feedback for our agencies. That happens a little too much, though. I haven't met a creative who doesn't want really straight feedback on the spot. We don't have the...
This is the J&J fan club.
I hope it's a creative.
I know we've got Mary's mum out there.
But, no, it's just, look, none of us have the time or the money or the interest anymore. But, if we see some work, if we say, oh, we're not pressured like this, can you tweak this and come back? When we really don't like it, we should tell you, let's move on. Because when we're clear, we send you the right, you know what, it's a beautiful thing.
Yeah. Oh. Pressure's on for applause now. So.
Yeah.
That must be your foot, Mrs. Erickson.
So we got that out of the way. For me, the thing that I would love to change is all of our silos. And it's not the agency silos, just the agency, it's our silos. And we really need to come together and break all of those down so we blend together so we can spend more time, less time talking to ourselves inside, and more time connecting with consumers outside so we can get the insights that translate into the basic creative ideas. That's what I wish we could do more.
Okay. Two things. One is a little bit, as Brian was saying, on our side. I think helping us be a better client, and we're focused on the front end, which is we've got to write better creative briefs. And we're working really hard to get better at that. But don't accept from us in any market a brief or assign a little bit of brief. And make sure that we've got the integrated group around the table from the start. So this doesn't start out as a 30-second ad that then gets translated into something else later. But the last thing I'd say in return is that I would look for a little more support in my pursuit of the balance of art and science, which I know isn't popular. It's not about copy testing every ad, but in partnership, getting better at being better is something I would like more partnership.
Okay. Well, I'd like to thank our panel, Mary, Beth, Brian, Marc, Mary, and permitting me to grovel in front of you. Thank you very much.
Very good. In fact, people tell me that the quality of the presentation, I'm not talking about us, the quality of the presentations are better this year than they've ever been. So the answers are that
invest
in your brand at a very difficult point in time. But all the evidence shows you invest in brands. Come out better, which is stronger, fitter, leaner. If the agencies come up, you have to balance it, because in places where you